Yesterday, the first session was about conviction, I guess we could say it that way. But we're focusing on a paradigm shift. The first session of this was about evaluating the health of the six different arenas of your life. So why that's important is not just this point in your life. It's also to protect you for when trauma comes at another point later on in your life. So some of you are in a really good place, and that's great. I mean, that's the goal, right? That's ideal. But you can't avoid tragedy, right? Circumstances change in your life, trauma happens, accidents happen, things happen that are outside of your control. And so some of the things we talked about were a little bit tough, were a little bit challenging. And I think some people probably walked away thinking, I understand what you're saying, but you don't get my family life. You don't get my emotional situation. You don't get the trauma I've been through. You don't get what's going on at home. You don't get, and you're right. It needs to be acknowledged that there are things outside of your control that can affect anyone or multiples of the six arenas of your life. So the plan today is to take the perspective from yesterday and turn that into a rhythm. See, this is an activity that you should do, even informally, even if you just take a second and think about how am I doing, because as we talked about yesterday, let's be honest, sometimes aspects of your life are going to suffer. Sometimes you have to spend more energy on your academics, or maybe your family needs you. Maybe you have to spend more energy on your family life. Maybe you're in a relationship and it's your turn to be the support system, and you need to be the kind of supportive partner that they need from you. So it's very likely that you're going to be in the yellow in a lot of aspects of your life. That's very normal. So I want to take that a step further for some perspective today. Okay? And what I want you to think about is we're trying to shift the focus of our goals away from little tiny micro specific things towards rhythms and patterns. See, I think one of the things that a lot of you probably understand really well, when times when you've been in a bad or a dark place and times when your life has been a lot better, is that order breeds more order and chaos breeds more chaos. And you see this in people because it seems to be a pattern in their life. If you look at the wheel of the six aspects of people's life, and it's like, I can't catch a break. I just keep losing my job. I can't get ahead financially. I can't get ahead academically. I can't. And it's like, well, yeah, all of these things are connected. So I don't want you to think, oh, well, I have to focus on academics, coach. What are you talking about? I got to get into college. I got to do. Exactly. But the point is that, and we're going to talk about this today, your circumstances change. The seasons of your life change. Trauma comes, and it's unexpected sometimes. Sometimes you're needed. Sometimes you need somebody else. So here's the point. The reason why you want to focus on the health of the six different arenas of your life is because you want to focus on what you can control. So if I have a good conversation with somebody and they're talking about how like their family life is just disastrous, like really just unsavory, and there's a very real concern here. It's like, well, I'm a teenager. I have at least another year in my parents' house. There's nothing I can do to change the red area of my family life. And that's important to acknowledge. That's true for that person. Maybe it's true for you. So in that situation, you have to focus not on your circumstances, which is always the case. You have to focus on the health of the rhythms of your life. See, if your family life or some other aspect of your life is doing particularly poorly, then the hope is that you have a health and functionality in some of the other areas of your life so that you can lean on that for support. So there's been two different times in my life that I know of now. I didn't really recognize it at the time, but where I suffered from minor bouts of depression, not anything to the level of a clinical type of depression. And we know that the depression is measured as MDEs, major depressive episodes. And major depressive episodes are like 14 consecutive days of depressive symptoms. But if you have multiple major depressive episodes in a single calendar year, then that's diagnosable as clinical depression. So now you're talking therapy, now you're talking possibly medication. So not to the clinical level. But there's been twice in my life that I consciously know I was dealing with major depressive episodes. And in both of those instances, I was pretty lost. It was kind of spilling over into the other aspects of my life. And where I was fortunate is that I had a strong support system. I had some other aspects of my life that were healthy so that when I needed mental support, I could lean on the other aspects that were healthy. And that's the point we want to get to today. You can't control everything. You can't make everything in your life the healthiest that it's ever been, which would be a 10 on this list. You don't have enough energy. You don't have enough time. You just can't do it. It's not realistic. But what you want to do is always evaluate, at least regularly evaluate, how am I doing? And maybe I've had to put, you know, family life on the back burner because I'm focusing on academics and this is a season of my life where it's like sink or swim. I've got to get into college. I've got to get my GPA up. I've got to do 5 projects. That happens. And it would be bad for you to ignore that and say, well, you know, coach says I got to focus on my mental health over academics, so I'm just going to drop out of school. No, that's not the point. The point is, but it's still important to acknowledge dysfunction. It's important to acknowledge when something is unhealthy because hopefully the circumstances of your life will change. That's going to be kind of the thesis for today, is that your circumstances are different than your purpose. If you want to be a higher functioning, healthier person, stop focusing on your circumstances and the little micro things and start focusing on the rhythms of your life. See, the circumstances might be out of your control. You're stuck in your parents' house. You're stuck in this city, on this little peninsula. You're stuck in this class right now. You're stuck at this stage of your life, and maybe you don't have much control over it. But you have choices. You're not a hapless victim. You have the ability to handle things inside of your control for the next phase of your life. See, what are you making excuses about that you could be focusing energy on? So I'm not going to promise you that there's a formula for making every aspect of your life as healthy as it could be. And if you're unhealthy, it's your fault. And you know, we talked about that yesterday. We're not trying to trauma blame here. What we're trying to do is get some perspective. And we have to differentiate, okay, if my relationship is bad, is that something that's in my control? What's my responsibility in this? What can I control? Or is it circumstantial? In which case, do I have the power to change these circumstances? If it's a relationship, you do have the power to change these circumstances. You can leave. If it's your family life, you probably don't have the power to change. So I understand. I'm empathetic to that. It needs to be said. It needs to be acknowledged that you can't always control your circumstances. People don't pick trauma. People don't pick struggle. Given the option, you would thrive and flourish. You wouldn't pick struggle just to build character. You would want your life to be easy and comfortable and awesome all the time. But that's not in your choices. That's not options that you have. So the purpose of trying to control what you can is so that your life doesn't spiral. Remember, things in your life impact the other arenas of your life, and you're either spiraling or you're snowballing up, right? Being complacent you'll only stay complacent for a small period of time because, like we talked about yesterday, what you nurture will thrive and what you ignore will eventually die. So it's important to know, like, okay, in this season of my life, I can't sleep as much and it's bad. Like maybe you're a nurse or like maybe you're in grad school or even right now in high school, it's like these 2 weeks are exam week and I have to cram. It's like, okay, well, so your physical health is going to take a dip. But the idea is that your circumstances have caused that and your circumstances should change. And I had a conversation with somebody and they're like, what do you expect me to do? I can't, like, this, my academics, I've got 5 AP classes and whatever. I'm like, but here's the thing you have to understand. That's this season of your life. You can't maintain this pace. So maybe in this season of your life, that's the reality, but it's not going to be like that next year. It's not going to be like that the following year. You can't keep up the pace that you're on for a long period of time or you will actually die. So that's the idea. If you let your circumstances dictate your purpose, then when bad things happen, you're going to spiral. So you need to focus on what you can control. And you need to focus on what you can pay some attention to. So let's take the metaphor a step further. The last slide that we went with yesterday was this one. And we ended with the metaphor of a path, a road, a destination. And that's what I'm going to use today. We're going to talk about the paths today. The 3 paths. The same thing as the back of this sheet. Is that arena of your life thriving? Is it complacent? Or is it dysfunctional? Is it destructive? And what you have to understand is, okay, yesterday you left, maybe you were a little convicted. You're like, okay, I get it, I understand, whatever. I need to make some changes. Well, there's some things to consider. Again, like we just talked about, there are things outside of your control. But let's talk about the things that are inside of your control. Even when the circumstances of your life are bad, you still have the future. So it's important that you, as old teenagers and early adults, you have to understand this. And maybe somebody's told you this, but I'm going to tell you anyway. You are going to turn into the people who are the biggest influences in your life. That will happen. The five closest friends you have, you're going where they're going. You're going to turn into them. You will turn into your parents if you don't do something differently, which might be fine. Some of your parents are phenomenal people, and that would be great. My point is, you unintentionally default to what you know. So learning what health looks like and dysfunction looks like and a toxic environment looks like helps you to understand what you want to change about your circumstances. See, maybe you live in a house where the relationship is not good. It's very toxic. It's tense all the time, and your parents are fighting, or your mom's under a lot of stress, or maybe it's one parent, or maybe it's like a step parent and you don't get along, or maybe you're like a half and you spend half time here and there. I don't know what your circumstances are, but let's say they're not ideal. Well, you can recognize that that's an unhealthy environment. But think about why that matters. Because if you can recognize health by recognizing dysfunction, then you can aim at something different. That's the point. It's about focusing on the rhythms of your life, not making small, short-term, finite goals. Right? So instead, like we talked about yesterday, making a goal, a New Year's resolution that says, I want to lose 10 pounds is not bad. That's a healthy goal to have, but that's a micro goal. And what we're going to learn today is that there's rhythms of your life. That's life change. Those are processes. So micro goals that you make should support your processes. So if we're looking at the rhythms of our life and we're saying in 2023, I'm going to focus on my physical health. I'm going to focus on my mental health. That's a process. That's a lifestyle change. So now every decision you make, those little micro decisions, that you need to filter those through the lens of, okay, is this support my goal or not? So then you're asking the wrong questions like, oh, well, you know, am I drinking too much? Well, how do you know? Well, the answer is this decision supporting my goal or not? If your goal is to be healthy, if your goal is to be well, if your goal is to be organized and orderly and not chaotic, then your decisions need to reflect that. I want to be a better student. Okay, then how are your day-to-day actions reflecting that? And you say, well, I don't have time. And that's a fallacy. It's not true. You say, I want to focus on my mental health in 2023. Okay, well, let's evaluate what's wrong with your mental health. I can't get ahead. I'm just anxious, and I can't really put any of these areas down. Exactly. Your life is chaotic. You can't cut out one of these arenas of your life. You need to find some balance. And so part of that is evaluating your schedule. I don't have time to focus on my mental health. Yes, you do. You spend most of your waking minutes staring at a 5-inch screen with just a nonstop scroll of dumb videos. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's not my point. But you don't recognize the opportunities that you have because those are choices. When you choose to spend 5 hours a day on your phone, don't complain that you don't have any time to focus on your mental health. Unless what you're watching on TikTok and short reels are motivational videos, which is possible. But that's part of the honest evaluation. If this is my goal, macro, process, I want to focus on my mental health in 2023, then the micro decisions have to support that goal. And now we don't have to say, oh, well, I'm going to go on this crash diet and I'm going to lose 12 pounds. Well, that's a micro goal. That's good. It's an outcome-based goal. That's healthy. But here's the thing. That needs to be one small micro decision that supports the greater, bigger goal. And the greater, bigger goal is because you want to be physically healthy. So losing 10 pounds doesn't matter if you don't sleep well, if you don't eat right, if you don't hydrate, if you drink too much. All of those things go against the goal. Who cares if you lost 10 pounds? Let's be honest. And there's the thing that kind of triggers people. It's like, oh, well, you got a goal to get into an Ivy League school. That's great. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But at what cost? If your mental health drops so low that you're actually suicidal, then who cares if you got into an Ivy League school? Because it's not going to be a good experience for you. So a goal was achieved. You did a good job. You set a goal. You took action steps towards that goal. You achieved the goal. But at what cost? Some people can balance things. Some people can't. I told you that story yesterday. When I came to the point where I realized I couldn't balance my schedule, I had to cut coaching out. It was an uncomfortable decision. It wasn't a decision I wanted to make. It was the right decision to make. Because my goal wasn't, yes, I'm going to do this or no. My goal was, I need to focus more energy on my personal life. That's how you change your mind. That's how your life gets better. Because here's what you know. It also happens conversely. So let's play a hypothetical scenario here. Your grades drop because you've been hanging out with your friends too much, cutting up in class, spend more time, you know, doing clowning around instead of doing work or whatever. So now your grades drop. Your academics drop down to a 4 or 3. So your parents are mad, so they ground you. So now you can't hang out with your friends. Your relationship aspect of your life drops, becomes less healthy. They take away your phone. You got no access to the world. You're mad at your parents. They're mad at you, so you're fighting. So one arena of your life has now impacted 2 or 3 other ones. Eventually, your mental health is going to be affected. You get lethargic. You lack motivation. You stop taking care of yourself. Your physical health declines. The same thing can happen in reverse. Focus your energies on health, things that are functional, growth, and then it will spill over into the other areas of your life. When you're getting along with the people in your family and you're supporting each other, then when trauma happens or you take a mental health decline, those people are there to support you as a safety net. Maybe you spend some time meditating. Maybe you spend some time soul searching. Maybe you spend some time reflecting introspectively, praying, whatever that looks like for you. It'll increase your spiritual health. It'll make you a better friend. You'll build, nurture, and health in those other arenas of your life. So your circumstances change. I get that. You can't always control your circumstances. That's why it's important to be as healthy as you can by focusing on the arenas of your life and focusing on the things that you can control. Remember, you're going in a direction. You're going to turn out like the people that influence you. Don't be so naive and immature to believe that you won't turn out like your friends. And conversely, it's kind of dumb anyway, because if you're like, okay, here's my goal. I'm going to change the financial cycle of my family. If you say, okay, my parents are loving, they do the best they can, but they just don't understand money. Okay, well, knowing that you will turn into them, because all of us do. I saw how my parents spent money. When I became an adult, I tried to spend money that way too. That's what happens. So if you don't get the model at home that you want, find it somewhere else. If you want to be a successful athlete, model yourself after successful athletes. Not just how they play and perform, but their habits too. If your parents or your household is a dysfunctional environment, seek out something healthier. People are like, oh, I want to be rich. And the first question you'd ask them is, what are you doing to become rich? I'm saving up money. You're an idiot. When was the last time you paid for and read a book on finances? Oh, they're boring. Congratulations. That's why the 3% is the 3% and not the 73%. And so we don't know anything about money and we think the system is rigged and then we complain and we become a victim. The reality is people are doing it, man. There's people in every walk of life, every color, every creed, every race, and every religion that are multi-millionaires in the United States. It's like, don't look at that example. If there's an exception, it disproves the rule. If there's systemic problems in America preventing people from being successful, then why are there successful people? It's a lie. It's a fallacy. If you want something, go do some research on it. Find out what it takes to become that. Don't just sit back on your heels and pretend like you know everything about the world. Look at us Twitter warriors complaining about what educated adult politicians who have been doing things for a long time. Like, look, politics will just make you angry. It's just going to rob you of mental well-being. I'm not saying ignore the problems of the world, but what are you going to do to fix that? You're allowing that to consume your thoughts and poison your mentality and ruin your day. Tomorrow's going to look the same as today for you, regardless of who's in the White House. It just is. Don't spend energy on that. Aim at something that you want to become. And recognize the fact that you're aiming at something anyway. You're traveling on a path. Question.
It was back to like the happiness slide. Like, how did you know when you were happy? Like, just saying, like, it's just like, you know, you can say you're happy, but like.
Yeah. No, it's a valid question because, like, again, I think sometimes people lie or they're just like, okay, is happy mean not sad? How do I know I'm happy? Oh, I'm in a good place. Well, it's like, are you in a good place or are you in like a meh place? So I think that's a good question to ask because.
Well, like, how did you know you were happy? Like, personally, like.
Well, sometimes you're not always happy. So I like what you're asking because we have to change the way we phrase that. Is the goal to be happy or is the goal to be content because your life has value? Right, again, so he wasn't here yesterday, but like I mentioned this yesterday, happiness is hitting the alarm in the morning, not getting up. So if we hit the alarm in the morning, we're going to be happy because that's what we wanted to do in the moment, but it's going to rob us of a functional life that has meaning. See, when you suffer from emotional distress, why will I not go backwards? There you go. The only thing you're motivated to do is to lay there. But forcing yourself to do something different is very hard. But it's going to lead to a more purposeful, fulfilling life. So happiness should not be the metric. Happiness is going to be contentment, which means that you feel well and you don't want for things. It's like, this is a good moment. This is a good day. I'm enjoying myself. I'm happy right now. Well, you'll have more happy days and moments and hours if your life is orderly and not chaotic. And think about this too, like, what happens when other people need you to support them? This is a good question, I like this. If you have chaos in your life, you're not available to support people. It's like, you're late to work every single day. You sleep in and you're late to school every day. Your life is chaotic, it starts chaotic, your hair is dripping, you don't get here on time, you're late to this class, you forgot to do work, you have no rhythms in your life, you have no routine, you have no order. So you can't even help yourself. Now when your friend needs you, you have no time for them. Hey, can you take me to work? They had a traumatic breakup. I really need to talk to you today. I can't. I had 2 weeks to study for this test and I didn't, so I'm gonna have to spend the next 4 hours cramming. See, your chaos and dysfunction doesn't just affect you. What happens when somebody else needs you, when they need to lean on you? And if you're not well, you can't be that for them. So like being happy is a byproduct of being healthy. You can't say, oh, well, you know, my mental health is the one. I've gotten used to it, YOLO. No. That's a dangerous, dangerous place because of this, right? We're going to talk about the paths in a second. You have to understand that destruction is a continuum. It's a continuum. You're spiraling out of control into more chaos, or you're snowballing into more success. Right? So let's drive this home. I want to make sure and point this out. This is something that's valuable to know, and maybe you want to write it down, but because it sounds harsh. Again, it sounds like we're victim blaming, but I need you to understand the difference here. The season of your life is your circumstance. That's your assignment. Right now, you're a teenager. You're in that season of your life. You're a student. You live in your parents' house. You work a part-time job. You don't get to pick your career. You don't get to pick your schedule. You have to go to school. All those things are your circumstances. But you make choices. You willingly come to school, even though you don't want to, because you know that's the healthy thing to do. It's going to get you where you want to go. So already you're practicing making healthy, functional decisions. But you can do them with less chaos and help yourself out and be mentally well. Your circumstances and your purpose are not the same thing. I know some of you are in a dark place. And some of you have been in a dark place, and even more of you will at some point be in a dark place. You got to trust me on this. It's a season. It'll pass. So don't destroy the other aspects of your life during that season, or you'll prolong it. Don't allow your academics to fall apart because your mental health is bad. Don't allow your friendships to fall apart because your physical health is bad. Don't allow the family relationships between the blood people who are there for you fall apart because you're in bad life patterns and bad friendships. Focus on health and function. Dysfunction breeds more dysfunction. Chaos breeds more chaos. Order breeds more order. Focus on order, rhythms, routine, discipline, intentionality, purpose. Purpose means paying attention to things that are important. If one of these six aspects of your life is important, I'm holding it up like you can see this from where you are. If one of these six aspects is important, then you need to be intentional about it. You need to pay attention to it. That's what it says. If it's thriving, if it's an 8, 9, or a 10, this area of your life has purpose and intentionality. Contentment and fulfillment will come from this level of health. It's because you're paying attention to it. You don't default to happiness. You default to comfort. And imagine this, like what happens if you were in a really, really bad situation? Let's say you're in a bad relationship. The comfortable thing to do is to ignore it. What if you're not confrontational and you're like, oh, things are bad. I need to get away from this. This is not good. I know it's not good. But I don't want to confront someone because I'm scared. That's valid. It makes sense. But if you continue down this road, it's not just going to magically fix itself. What's going to happen is it's going to become destructive and it's going to get dysfunctional. Just like I mentioned yesterday with the marriage or a romantic relationship. If you ignore the health of the relationship, it doesn't just get better. Because fulfillment, purpose, intentionality, that takes attention. You got to focus on it. You got to pay attention to it. If I don't pay attention to my marriage, it's not going to get better. It's just going to slide. And that's where the complacency, that's where the yellow line, that's the dangerous one. Because it's easy to recognize dysfunction and we can't always change it. It's hard to acknowledge when something has gotten complacent. But it's important to recognize that. And maybe the season will change. Maybe the season will change and the circumstances will change. But if we don't have good rhythms and we don't pay attention to things that matter and control what's in our power to control, then we're not going to be ready for that change. Because think about this. What if your home life is terrible and you can't wait to get away from your parents, but you let it affect your mental health and you let it affect your friendships and you get destructive patterns, you start doing drugs and your grades slip? Well, now you don't have any options. So instead of being able to move away from the dysfunctional environment you live in, you now have to stay there. You're not financially stable and you can't go to college. If you don't like where you're at, take steps to change your circumstances. You may have to be patient. You don't always get a fair shake. You don't always get what you deserve, right? It's the fallacy of fairness. Now, let's assume that you've decided, okay, I'm going to shift the way I look at my life. Maybe I'm good. Maybe things are good, but I have to pay more attention to things and not let them get out of control and become chaotic. Maybe your life is just a little chaotic and you're like, I would just like to relax and chill a little bit in 2023 and not be so stressed all the time. I'm not like bad. Nothing's really in the red, but I got a lot of yellow. Okay, regardless of when you decide to change, there's some things that you should know. And one of the things you have to understand is, again, we default to comfort. So if you don't want to default to comfort, you're going to have to make some uncomfortable choices. Change is scary. It's not easy. Sometimes you have to decide, hey, this person that's my closest friend in the world that I've been hanging out with since fourth grade is absolutely a toxic human being, and I need to cut them out of my life. That's not an easy decision to make. It's going to require some purpose, some intentionality. So there's some things that you should understand. It's not always going to go smoothly. So you know, okay, I default to what I know. Maybe I want to learn more about finances, or maybe, you know, like I love my parents and they're good with money and I'm happy with who they are and how I'm turning out, but like they really want me to do this job or study this thing and I just don't want to. That's a tough, uncomfortable decision to make. At some point you're gonna have to look your parents in the face and say, I'm not working in the family company, Dad. I'm joining the military, Dad. You're gonna break your parents' heart and they cry and blah blah blah. But it's your life. You have to be intentional. It's uncomfortable. And people don't always understand life change. And I'll tell you this, whether you're an athlete or whatever, it doesn't matter. Unsuccessful people don't recognize success. People who are toxic are the same way. They probably don't realize they're toxic. So when you become healthy, they're not going to understand that and they're going to reject it. So you better be prepared. It's going to ruffle some people up when you change your life. It's going to change your perspective. It's going to change your surroundings, right? So changing your life significantly can require stepping out of your comfort zone and drastically altering your surroundings. So the first thing you have to understand, and again, I promised you it's not like a 9-step process to becoming rich or a 5-step process to becoming wealth. These are just things that you need to understand are part of the process. And one of them you already did. You just came to the conclusion that something has to change. Maybe not drastically, but maybe a little bit. Maybe you're like, okay, I don't get enough sleep, and I'm not healthy, and I'm not well. It's like, I make it, I'm fine, I'm happy, my mental health is good, my friendships are good, academics are going good, those things are fine. I've finally made it to the point where I don't have to stress about my grades anymore. Maybe it's just small little parts of your life. It doesn't have to be dramatic, but you do have to acknowledge that it needs to happen. Because that's the goal. It's not like, oh, I'm going to lose 10 pounds. It's like, oh, no, I'm going to focus on my health. And I'm going to get into better shape. And so your micro goals are going to support the process. They're going to support the rhythm. So something that you should seriously consider doing, and I told you this before in a previous lesson, is you're 7 times more likely to complete a goal by writing it down. And that's a weird thing, but that makes it real. It's not just something in your head. Write it down. Put it somewhere where it's visible. Manifest it, as people say. No, you're acknowledging this is a goal I have. Now, those goals need to be about processes. They need to be about healthy rhythms in your life. You're going to see why in just a second in the story I'm going to show you. Make a plan. Now, a plan doesn't have to be so significantly detailed because you can't control all the aspects, but you got to know what you're up against. It's like, okay, well, I want to go to Harvard and you're a junior in high school. Well, that's not going to happen. That's a hard conversation to have with athletes. You're a junior in high school and you don't have any offers. It's not going to happen, man. I'm sorry. I know you want it to happen. It's a harsh reality. It's like you're a good person. You deserve it. But you just need to be realistic. No, you needed to go back and shake your 13-year-old self and say, this is a goal I have. Okay, again, what road are you on? You want to be a Division I athlete? What habits in your life reflect that goal? Probably none. Probably none. You can't be half in. It costs you something. To be an elite athlete, an elite musician, an elite writer, there's things that you're going to have to pay for. You're not going to be able to do all the social things that your friends are doing. You're not going to be able to keep up with some of the other things that are going on. You're going to have to make sacrifices. So decide what is valuable to you. You don't get to live the same kind of comfortable, relaxed, easygoing life and then just default to success. You have to make a plan. What do I have to give up? What do I have to pay attention to? So when you're getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning and you're going to work or you're going to run or you're going to hit the gym, other people are sleeping. And you know why, right? You have to understand what's important to you. You have to be intentional about it, but you have to have a plan. And if it's too late for you, then tell the others. Tell the others. Tell your little siblings, hey, sixth grade idiot. Hey man, I know you're not thinking about this because you're 12, but someday you might want to be serious about your athletic career. Someday you might want to be serious about your academics. If you decide you want to go to Harvard, that's probably determined in elementary school. I hate to break that to you. People are groomed for that for over a decade. It's just the reality of the situation. So you have to have a plan. If it's not realistic, change your focus. And that's why outcomes are not the strategy. That's the whole point. Your life will still have the same purpose if you don't get a Division I scholarship. Your life will still have the same purpose if you don't get into Harvard. Because that's your circumstances. It's not your purpose. You can still go to another college and be perfectly happy. You'll probably meet the people that'll be your friends forever. You may meet your spouse. Your purpose and your circumstances are different things. So it's okay to have a plan. But your world is not going to fall apart if the plan falls apart. Have goals. It's healthy. But understand that goals and the circumstances are different than the purpose of your life. Partner wisely. Surround yourself with people who are positive influences and people who support what you're trying to be. Some of your friends are really toxic humans, and maybe it's not their fault, but it doesn't matter because it's still going to affect you. And if you're not in a good place or you're not heading in a good direction and the people who are closest to you are not good influences on you, then you need to do the uncomfortable thing and walk away from them. And don't be half in. Well, if I just, I know my friend's bad for me. Somebody talked to me about that yesterday. But I can't really turn my back on them. I'm just going to kind of like distance myself and I'm going to, okay. Let's see how that turns out. People are going to oppose your life change because they don't understand it. You need to be ready for that. Expect opposition. When you're changing your life, you're being successful. Other people who don't want you to be successful are not going to understand that. I'm just telling you. Okay? I want to show you a story in a second that's going to drive home this point that the circumstances in your life are different than the purpose of your life. And that when the purpose of your life is health and function, and when you create this goal and plan and it doesn't work out the way you want it to, your life doesn't lose its meaning. Your purpose doesn't change because your circumstances don't work out. Right? Because you can do everything right. You say, okay, it's new year, new me. I'm gonna get up in the morning. I'm going to go to the gym 4 days a week, take one rest day, take the weekends off. It's like, that's an action step. That's a plan. You can write it down. You can tape it on the mirror. But the reality is this. If you wait till you're motivated to do it, it's not going to happen. Happiness is hitting the alarm. Discipline is getting up. So you have to be committed. You have to think long-term, not short-term. Yesterday, I gave this quote, you know, immature people will give up long-term fulfillment for happiness in the moment. That's a sign of immaturity. You have no self-control. So you'll give up long-term success, happiness, fulfillment, health, in order to get what you want in the moment. So be disciplined enough to walk away from things that won't get you where you want to go. Right? That's something that's important to know.